The Lord be with you.
Okay.
Today we honor our first responders, medical personnel, and those also on the front lines in the military that are serving overseas and here in the States fighting terrorism, especially as we recall 20 years ago from yesterday was 9/11, and the question that people often ask is, where were you? What were you doing? And I'm going to address today, where was God during this whole time? So God is with us today. He's with us as he serves us through his word and sacraments. He's among his people, and that's the good news. God is with us, and who can be against us? And the assurance that we're in his favor through Jesus. So let's begin with our praise and worship by singing hymn 726, Evening and Morning. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, kept the record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Be strong and let your heart take courage. But I trust in you, O Lord. My times are in your hand. Make your face shine on your servant. Glory be to the Father and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Be strong, and let your heart take courage. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lamb of God, our Savior.
take our sins away. Have mercy on us, Jesus. Receive our heartfelt cry. Where you empower our seated at God's right hand on high. For you alone are holy, you only are the Lord. Forever and forever, be worshipped and adored. You with the Holy Spirit, alone are Lord Most High, in God the Father.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, our support and defense in every need, continue to preserve your church in safety. Govern her by your goodness and bless her with your peace. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The first reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4 through 10. The sovereign Lord has given me a well-instructed tongue to know the word that sustains the weary. He wakens me morning by morning, wakens my ear to listen like one being instructed. The sovereign Lord has opened my ears. I have not been rebellious. I have not turned away. I offer my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pull out my beard. I did not hide my face from mocking and spitting, because the sovereign Lord helps me. I will not be disgraced. Therefore, have I set my face like flint? And I know I will not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near, who when will bring charges against me? Let us face each other. Who is my accuser? Let him confront me. It is the sovereign Lord who helps me. Who will condemn me? They will all wear out like a garment. The moths will eat them up. Who among you fear the Lord and obey the words of his servant? Let the one who walks in the dark, who has no light, trust in the name of the Lord and rely on their God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We speak from Psalm 116 responsively. I love the Lord because he has heard. Because he inclined his ear to me. The snares of death encompassed me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. The Lord preserves the simple. Return, O my soul, to your rest. For you have delivered my soul from death. I will walk before the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The epistle reading is from, was taken from James chapter 3, verse 1 through 12. Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault is what they say it is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take chips as an example, although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are stirred by a very small rudder, wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is also part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a whirl of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body, sets the whole course of one's life on fire, and is itself set to fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, but full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives, or a grape vine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 9th chapter. When they came to the other disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and the teachers of the law arguing with them. As soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. "What are you arguing with them about?" he asked. A man in the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought you my son who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not." "You unbelieving generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." So they brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, "How long has he been like this?" "From childhood," he answered. "It has often thrown him into the fire or water to kill him." But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for one who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. When Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the impure spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. After Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, this kind can come out only by prayer. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We confess our faith in the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten of me, being of once was with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets, and I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated for the children's message. We have no children here physically that I see, but maybe they're watching at home. And we have, of course, children at heart among us. All of us are children of God. And I want to remind everybody here of the victory we have in Jesus, especially sometimes we feel like we're losers. Maybe our friend says we're a loser. Or we lost a ball game, or there we go, Abby's here. Hey, Abby. So, or maybe you lost a soccer game. Did you lose a soccer game? Did you win? You didn't win? So sometimes you feel like, oh, I'm a loser. And we feel defeated in life sometimes when we're not having a good day, particularly a day, most of all of you weren't born, obviously, 20 years ago, on a 9/11 day when it looks like everything's going wrong. But here's the good news that we can look forward to our victory sign, and that's the cross of Jesus. That Jesus died on the cross for our sins that we might be forgiven and have eternal life. Therefore, we can always know that we're victorious in Jesus. And here's a good object lesson. If you look in this church and sanctuary, you can see lots of crosses. Can you see a cross up here? See a cross at our altar? See a cross above our baptism font. See a cross, of course, our altar, our crucifix, where Jesus died. You see a cross on our hymnals. You see crosses all over the place in this church, but also outside the church, you can see crosses too. Some people wear jewelry. Maybe somebody wears jewelry with a cross. Or if you're in math class, what's the plus sign? Cross, right? Or a T, if you have a T in your name, there's a T, you see a cross. And I was taught this, I didn't know this till I was much older, about this door that you can't see too well up here, but there's a shape of a door that became very popular during the Puritan era, many, many years ago, that they would put a cross, design their door with a cross and an open Bible on the bottom. And yesterday, when I was running in River Forest, I saw several doors that have this shape today. Maybe your house has this if you look around or look inside doors in your house. And these all are symbols of what Jesus has done for us. So if you ever feel defeated in life, I remind you to look to the cross of Jesus where you have forgiveness and salvation and eternal life. And you can be assured you're God's child. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for providing a way for us to get to heaven. If there are some here today who have not found the way, we pray that they will find your way today. In Jesus' name, amen. Continue with our sermon hymn.
Seen thirsting let us pray first to
grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our text, taken from for this observance of the 20th anniversary of 9/11 and Heroes Sunday, is taken from Genesis chapter 28, reading from verses 10 through 19. And Jacob went off out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows, and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it, and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, thy father, and the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the south, north, and to the south. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land. For I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. And Jacob awakened out of his place, And he said, surely the Lord is in this place. And I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. And Jacob arose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil upon it. And he called the place of that place, and he called the name of that place Bethel, but the name of that city was called Luz at the first. Here ends our text. So where were you on September 11th, 2001? Most all of us who lived through that day can recall exactly where we were and what we were doing when we first found out about the terrorist attacks. But you might also ask, where was God on 9/11? And where is God now in the current midst of this coronavirus pandemic, in addition to other times of crises in your life? Where is God when the doctor says your loved one has terminal cancer? Where is God when your boss says you're fired? Where is God when your boyfriend or girlfriend says, let's just be friends? Where is God when you get cut from the team? And where is God in the current crisis you're going through right now in your life? If we put ourselves in Jacob's sandals, we can imagine that he must have been asking the same question in his life. Where was God? For Jacob, with the help of his mom, Rebecca, had deceived his elderly dad, Isaac, into receiving the firstborn blessing before Isaac died. Even though he got the blessing from his dad, his older brother, Esau, was so angry he wanted to take his life. So there was Jacob on his own for the first time in his life, a fugitive, feeling lonely, scared, not exactly how he was going to get through the day, let alone the future. Perhaps you recall a similar feeling on 9/11 20 years ago. Feeling lonely, scared, and not exactly how you're going to get through the day, let alone how you're going to make it in the future. Just as any crises in our lives, including the current pandemic we're going through, can make us feel like we're living out the parable of the wise and foolish builders in Matthew chapter 7, where every earthly prop seems to be giving way in the midst of life's storms, and only the solid rock of Jesus and his words of life can prevent us from falling down with a great crash. And these times of crisis in our lives can cause us to grow so weary, not just physically, but spiritually and mentally as well. So again, we can relate to Jacob when he was so tired and weary that he slept like a rock, or in this case, on a rock. Although I trust you won't fall asleep on the rock hard pew you're sitting in this morning during this message. But here's the comforting news that Jacob came to know in the midst of his despair. In spite of his outer circumstances, God was with him. And most of all, in spite of his past sins, it must have made him feel like he might have been not only out of favor with man, especially his brother Esau, but God himself. Yet, in spite of his unlovableness, God still loved him. And the same goes for you and me. And he communicated his love for Jacob by giving him a dream of a ladder reaching up to heaven where angels were ascending and descending upon it, assuring Jacob that in spite of his current circumstances, he was still a child of Abraham with all its rights and privileges, and that God was sending his angels with orders from heaven to fulfill the marvelous plan he had for Jacob's life as one of the patriarchs of the promised Messiah, in spite of his dirty, rotten, scoundrel times. But my friend, you don't need a dream of a ladder reaching up to heaven to be assured of God's love for you and his grace and favor on your life, in spite of your being a dirty, rotten scoundrel at times. For not only does God assure you of his love, forgiveness, and salvation through his word and his sacraments and holy baptism and holy communion, all you have to do, as I mentioned in the kids' sermon, is to look to the cross of Jesus as a visible reminder how you've been given access to heaven. For upon the cross, Jesus died for your sins that you might have forgiveness, salvation, and life more abundantly. As a child of Abraham, through saving faith in Jesus as the promised Messiah, and thus become an ambassador of heaven by letting your light so shine before men throughout your earthly sojourn to the promised land of heaven. And just as Jacob had a vision of angels ascending and descending upon that ladder, So you can be assured that God is fulfilling the marvelous plan that he has for your life. And he's sending his holy angels from heaven to assist you in it. And so I pray that whenever you feel lonely and scared and having a 9/11 type of day, that just as the prophet Elisha prayed for his servant Gehazi, eyes to be opened when they were surrounded by the Arameans in 2 Kings chapter 6, that your spiritual eyes would be open, that you would have, that is the fact that you have the host of angels on your side. And be able to say along with Elijah, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. In addition, to be assured that if God is for you, who can be against you? And along with his holy angels, God has blessed us with earthly messengers of his mercy that too often we take for granted until we need them, that we're recognizing in today's service as heroes. Those in the medical field, along with those, the first responders and military members. 20 years ago, we watched their bravery as police, firefighters, and healthcare workers ran towards danger to save the lives of the World Trade Center towers and the Pentagon on 9/11. And we were to, later on, witness the courage of tens and thousands of troop members who were deployed on missions to defeat terrorism. Today, we continue to honor these men and women on the front lines of the medical community, as well as those who patrol our streets and keep our communities safe, whether responding to an outbreak of disease, crime, putting out fires, and calming the civil unrest, along with the hundreds of thousands of active duty U.S. personnel still serving combat deployments and peacekeeping missions around the world. Of course, the events of 9/11 and other tragic events in our lives serves to remind us that we're not in heaven yet. But as we look to the cross upon which our Savior died, we can find comfort that even if we should die, heaven is our real and eternal home. And no matter what we suffer in this life for our Christian faith, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. In fact, if you look close enough, I contend that you can find the symbol of the cross just about everywhere you happen to be. Whether it's on a piece of jewelry, the letter T in the alphabet, the plus sign in math, the door I talked about earlier, referred to earlier. Observing the trees that serve to remind you that upon a cross made from a tree, your Savior died. Or if you can't find a cross where you're at, simply by making the sign of the cross in remembrance of your baptism. And by continually focusing upon the cross of Jesus upon which your Savior died, soon you'll become cross-eyed as you see all the events of your life and of this world through the lenses of a beloved, forgiven child of God, confident that God is working out things for good in your life, no matter how seemingly tragic. And even if you should die unexpectedly, as hundreds of Christians did on 9/11, you can be assured that your death will have been swallowed up in victory as your gateway to heaven. And so we join Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego when they were threatened to be thrown in the fiery furnace if they didn't bow down to the statue of Nebuchadnezzar, saying, "Our God is able to deliver us. But even if he doesn't, we will not bow down to the statues and idols of this fallen world." Confident that on the cross, Jesus has made us not only conquerors in this brief life, but even more importantly, forever conquerors in the next. September 11, 2001, of course, is a date that will not be forgotten. And in New York City, where nearly 3,000 lives had been claimed, the terrorist attack had left behind a scene of incomprehensible destruction, heartache, and despair. Following the attack, a massive operation was launched to clear the site in an attempt to find any survivors amongst the rubble. The pile was so big and there was so much dust and smoke, nobody knew what to say or do. So they kept on digging harder and harder, hoping to find somebody alive. Instead, they worked for days with the smell of death on them, the whole time their hearts in their throats. On September 13th, 2001, the workers had dug their way down to a cavern. One of them, named Frank Celestia, walked to its edge, where below there was a big crater, and never said a word. He didn't have to. Where he had discovered a 17-foot-tall cross made from two steel beams among the debris of the World Trade Center. There, in the midst of all the death and decay, somehow in all that darkness, God's light had shone through. One of Frank's coworkers shouted out to him, "Man, it was worth it, wasn't it?" To which Frank responded back saying, "Oh yeah, yeah, it was worth it." The cross, known as the World Trade Center cross or the Ground Zero cross, has served for many as a symbol of faith, hope, and healing. It continues to be displayed today as a crucial part of the 9/11 Memorial Museum today. People of God, in the midst of the 9/11 times of your life, when it appears all hope is gone and God is nowhere to be found, look to the cross of Jesus as the anchor of the rocking boat of your life. For upon the cross, Jesus demonstrated just how much God loves you, that he gave up his life so that you might be his forever child, and nothing will be able to separate you from his love. Therefore, on this 20th anniversary of 9/11, along with the current pandemic and the shifting culture of today's crazy mixed-up world, let us resolve even more so with the help of the Holy Spirit to be wise men and wise women of God, who build our lives on the solid rock of Christ and hear his words and put them into practice. For all their ground is sinking sand. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Jesus Christ. Amen. In our prayers today, we especially pray for some of our heroes, our friends, and members of Messiah. I'll mention later on, along with some of the medical and first responders and armed forces. And we also continue to pray for Marilyn and Ed Ursh, that are being hospitalized, and Juan Pagan, who's suffering from COVID. And we pray for others mentioned in our bulletin. Let us pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, we believe, help our unbelief. Sustain us through the many troubles and trials of this world. When unclean spirits afflict us and those that we love, revive our trust in you, Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, knowing that those who teach in the church will be judged with greater strictness, bless the teachers of our synod schools, colleges, and seminaries. Preserve them faithful to your word, that they may not stumble in what they say. Lord, in your mercy. Lord and Father, tame our tongues, so that they are not a restless evil full of deadly poison. Turn them by your Spirit from cursing the people made in your likeness to instead blessing you, and keep us from stumbling in what we say. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, guard the tongues of our governing authorities, that they may not stumble in what they say, but speak wisely, leading in accord with your will. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you have promised that all things are possible for one who believes. In such faith, we bring before you Marilyn, Ed, Juan, and all others in need, asking you to grant them health and healing. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, your Son, who suffered unjustly for our sins and was vindicated in his resurrection, is near to us in his body and blood. Assure us that no one can contend against or declare guilty those who have been reconciled to God in Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of all nations, God of all people, we praise you for answering the prayers of your people as we sought your mercy and protection following the events of September 11, 2001. Your providence and care have given to us daily bread and protection from enemies. Let us ever trust your mercy even as enemies continue to threaten our peace. Bring comfort through your word to those whose hearts are heavy on this anniversary. May they find their hope in your Son's victory over evil and the grave. Turn all our hearts to Jesus, who is our life and for our salvation. We especially give thanks and pray for Nancy Abraham, Bob Burke, Kathy Burke, Conrad Dombowski, Nicholas D'Angelo, Barbara Canast, Gloria Mahler, Ziggy Modzeleski, Harvey Rubin, Kay Rubin, Al Santos, Kelly Santos, Patrick Scalzetti, Frank Suster, Jim Suster, Keith Thornton Jr., Andrew Vinicos, Richard Wegberry, Tommy Waldarchek, Carlos Yanis Jr., the families of Sergeant Michael Lilly, Corporal Jason Kazarek, and Staff Sergeant Joseph Gamboa. We also pray for those in Engine 125 and Truck 53, the 25th District Police Department, Millennium Periodontist, 16th District Police Department, West Loop Dental, Michigan Avenue Interns, and all first responders and armed forces. Turn all of our hearts to Jesus, who is our life and salvation, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Lord, in your mercy, all these things and whatsoever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we sit at all times and in all places. Give thanks to you, O Holy Father, Almighty Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love, shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh, and laid on him our sin, giving him into death, that we may not die eternally. Because he has now risen from the dead, and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death, and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of Sabaoth adored, heaven and earth are full of him. Shout the glory of his name. And Hosanna, sing, Hosanna, sing, Hosanna to the Lord. Truly blessed is he comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us, and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. In your righteous judgment, you condemned the sin of Adam and Eve, who ate the forbidden fruit, and you justly barred them and all their children from the tree of life. Yet in your great mercy, you promised salvation by a second Adam, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who made his cross a life-giving tree for all who trust in him. We give you thanks for the redemption you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may faithfully eat and drink of the fruits of his cross and receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Christ, can we die for our sins? The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Depart in only peace, for I have seen the glory of your redeeming grace. A light to lead the Gentiles unto your holy hill. The glory of your people, your chosen Israel. A glory to the Father, a glory to the Son, a glory to the Spirit, forever three in one. For as in the beginning, is now, shall ever be, God's triune name resounding through all eternity.
Let us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you've given us a foretaste of the feast to come and the holy supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage. And on the day of his coming, we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
That old and sick
Okay, maybe seated. Well, you're already seated. So, we do have fellowship today honoring our heroes. So join us for fellowship downstairs. And thanks for Barb and Michael for providing that today. We also want to remind you of a couple upcoming events. This Saturday, the Indoor Outdoor Crafts and Vendor Sale. Michael, you want to say something? You can. Okay, make sure while you're there, please come with your, if you can, come with your merch, as Michael says, church merch. Identify yourself as a Messiah member and share the good news with him. Offer to pray with him. We have prayers every Friday. And please invite them to come to worship with us, along with their kids for Sunday school as well. So just don't just show up and gab, but have a purpose behind this outreach. We also have our community fest coming up September 26th. Looking forward to that. Next Sunday, by the way, Miguel and Annabelle will officially join our church. They're members already, but they're so good to see them in worship. And hopefully we have a lot of people here next Sunday for our Back to Church Sunday. Please invite people. We have postcards in the back. You see those still to this day. Share those with somebody you know that is perhaps looking for a church home. And please give us names of potential people that you know, the prospects that might be interested in worshiping with us here at Messiah. The kids come to our Sunday school, which we start this Sunday. So keep that in mind. We always want to have a running prospect list of potential people that need a good church home where the gospel is being proclaimed and the sacraments rightly administered. So make that a habit. Anything else I'm missing? Okay, all right. Okay, see you downstairs. Go in peace and serve the Lord.